This is the second part of a series exploring the findings of the Australian Royal Commission into institutional responses to child sexual abuse. In part one, I looked at the first of two cases of abuse investigated within the Jehovah's Witness organisation, the case of a woman codenamed BCB, who was abused by an elder, a spiritual leader in her congregation. Chairing the commission was Justice Peter McClellan. Assisting counsel for the commission was Angus Stewart, QC. As that case showed, various policies of the Jehovah's Witnesses combine very effectively to protect child molesters and silence their targets. The organisation demands that there are two or more witnesses to the molestation, or that the molester confesses, both of which are highly unlikely. Those who are found guilty can be disfellowshipped, a form of excommunication in which individuals are shunned by the entire organisation. But this is also highly unlikely, because molesters are told if they express repentance, they'll simply be reproved. Their congregation is informed that they've been reprimanded for an unspecified transgression. What is highly likely is that abused children, receiving no justice and faced with continued exposure to their molester, will feel driven to leave the organisation. Unfortunately, this can result in them being shunned. No provision is made for individuals who simply want to stop being a Jehovah's Witness, but maintain personal relationships with other members. They're not given that choice. They must remain under the organisation's authority, or dissociate themselves, and be completely shunned. Even if they decide to stay, abused individuals who develop alcohol, drug, or other related problems can find themselves disfellowshipped for that. The cards are stacked overwhelmingly against abused children. But the Commission's second investigation into the organisation, the case of BCG, would uncover evidence of unsuspected new depths of corruption. Taking the witness stand, BCG testified to the following account. She was born in Brisbane in 1971, the second oldest of seven children, with an older sister and two younger sisters. Her father joined the organisation when she was very young, followed by her mother, and became a ministerial servant, assisting the elders of the congregation. He exercised dictatorial control, forbidding his family from reading non-Jehovah's Witness literature or associating with non-members. BCG was baptised at 16. She was sure the congregation knew about her father's violent nature. He frequently beat her with a leather strap, and she'd sometimes attend meetings still bleeding. She had blurry feelings that he'd abused her sexually around age 5, and a clear recollection of inappropriate kissing and sexual compliments from him in her early teens. At 17, the abuse escalated when her mother and siblings were away for a fortnight in Brisbane. Left alone, she was repeatedly assaulted by her father. Despite her father threatening to beat her and kick her out if she spoke to anyone without him being present, BCG eventually approached the wife of an elder called Kevin Bowditch, but was told he couldn't talk to her without her father present. Twice, she approached another elder, Dino Ally, a good friend of her father's. Despite her obvious distress, again, she was told her father had to be present. Eventually, BCG told the person who would become her future husband. He persuaded Ally to meet him and BCG. She said Ally seemed incensed at her and warned her she was making a very serious allegation. She said she knew that. A number of meetings were arranged between BCG, Ally, Bowditch, and another elder, Ron DeRoy. She wasn't told about their purpose. Again, she was met with anger and asked highly inappropriate questions, like, "Did you enjoy it?" Because the elders were all male and also her father's friends, she was reluctant to give them details and only answered direct questions. They instructed her to tell her mother about the abuse. When she did, her mother revealed that her father had abused her older sister. BCG asked how she could have left her alone with him. Her mother said she didn't think he'd do it again because he was a Jehovah's Witness. BCG and her mother then spoke to the two youngest daughters, around ages 5 and 7. They both reported sexual assaults by their father. BCG and her mother told the elders, but Ron DeRoy told them, We don't want to talk to your sisters because they're too young to know what they're talking about. The elders said BCG had to put her allegations to her father. Terrified, she went ahead for the sake of her younger sisters. In the meeting, her father threatened to flog her, hit her, and kill her. The elders only intervened when he got up and moved towards her. Eventually, he was disfellowshipped. But DeRoy told her it wasn't for abusing her, but for some other misconduct. When she asked why, he said they needed two or more witnesses. When she mentioned her sisters, he said it had to be the same event. Her father appealed his disfellowshipping, and BCG was called to appear before a judicial panel of three elders from other congregations. She had to recount her experiences all over again, but eventually her father confessed to stepping out of line. His appeal was rejected. Eventually, he moved away from the area. BCG said many congregation members accused her of lying. Although she was married later that year, she felt worthless and alone, and attempted suicide by overdose, an act for which she was later chastised by DeRoy because it was considered a serious transgression against Jehovah. A few years later, DeRoy informed her that her father was being reinstated because he was doing all the right things. When asked what these right things were, he said her father was attending meetings. She reminded him her father was attending meetings when he was abusing her and her sisters. BCG told DeRoy the congregation wasn't safe and she was going to take it to the police. In response, she said he quoted a Bible passage that forbids taking brothers to court, and he warned that she could be disfellowshipped for bringing reproach on Jehovah. She wrote to senior officials in the organization, but no action was taken. Instead, they sent a letter counseling her to preserve her tears in a skin bottle. This was a reference to Psalms 56 verse 8, which depicted the biblical God collecting tears in his skin bottle and recording them in a book. After her third son was born, she separated from her husband and left the organization. Disillusioned by its hypocrisy and doubting the claim that its senior members were divinely appointed. On leaving, she reported her abuse to the police. Unlike the Jehovah's Witness organization, the secular courts had rules protecting her from inappropriate questioning. Her father was convicted and given a 3-year sentence. Speaking about the police and the Royal Commission staff, she said she'd had more support, acknowledgement, and acceptance from complete strangers than she'd ever had from her congregation, and she hoped that the Jehovah's Witness organization would be made criminally and financially accountable for its failure to protect children. Dino Ally, an elder for 20 years, was the first to be questioned about the BCG case. He was asked about why he'd initially dismissed her request to talk to him. Ally embarked on a lengthy defense that was conflicted to the point of incoherence. He claimed absolutely no recollection of the conversation, then declared he would never have told her to talk to her father first, then said there wasn't enough information to comment on whether he would say that, then he said he wasn't denying what she'd said. Finally, in the most strangulated evasion, he said, "I'm not saying that I'm denying that that's something that she may have assumed that I said or that she said." Instead of giving up in the face of this protracted tap dance, Judge McClellan continued to pursue a straight answer. He established that the organization requires members to first approach those they have a disagreement with. He then suggested that BCG's testimony that Ally told her to talk to her father first was consistent with this teaching. Finally, after more tap dancing, Ally admitted the consistency. It took a staggering 11.5 minutes to push through Ally's deflections and evasions to get that simple acknowledgement, and that was on an incident he didn't even recall. Ally claimed he and the other elders all believed BCG's allegations, but said they couldn't act on that belief without corroboration from another person. In line with the organization's policies, he said they needed either 2 witnesses to the abuse or a confession from the perpetrator. But as the commission went on to show, both these requirements were fulfilled. Ally initially claimed not to recollect the allegations made by BCG's younger sisters, but a document called Notes of Investigating Committee was later produced by Stewart. It had been obtained from the police, who'd used it in their prosecution of BCG's father. It was handwritten by Ally and dated at the time of the original meetings with BCG. In it, Ally noted that BCG's father had possibly abused the two younger daughters, as well as the older daughter, at age 2. Ally further noted that BCG's father had admitted that all the allegations of molestation were true. So, the elders had multiple witnesses and a confession, and yet they did nothing. Judge McClellan pointed out that Ally had previously told him he hadn't got a confession. After some flustering, Ally claimed they needed to make sure the confession was true. It was incoherent nonsense. Ally had previously stated that all the elders believed BCG's account, but on receiving a confession that confirmed the account they already believed, they were suddenly unwilling to accept the confession was true. Ally's suggestion that confessions needed to be substantiated was shown to be false. When BCG's father confessed at his appeal hearing, in front of 3 elders from other congregations, it was accepted. Ally's requirement of further substantiation was an unnecessary, cruel, and callous imposition on an abused individual who had jumped through hoop after humiliating hoop to meet all the organization's judicial requirements. Like many elders summoned to speak to the commission, Kevin Bowditch showed no great concern for the consequences of failing to deal with molesters. When questioned about the potential danger from a known child molester to the wider community, including children outside the organization, he glibly responded, "What ability have we got to protect every child in Australia?" When Stewart gave the obvious answer that they could report to the child protection authorities, Bowditch said that was done in some cases. But Stewart put it to him that this wasn't a voluntary practice. It wasn't done unless there was a legal requirement to do so. Bowditch confirmed that was true. As with virtually all the elders summoned to testify, including Ally, Bowditch had declined to watch BCG's testimony or read her statement. Stewart asked why this was. Bowditch claimed it was because he preferred to be truthful and speak from his own point of view. When Stewart asked Bowditch why abused individuals were required to face their abusers, he suggested it could start the healing process. He said it was so people like BCG could get it out and tell the person who'd carried out this vile act. But in Bowditch's own statement, he recalled BCG's father being verbally aggressive and physically threatening towards his daughter, who appeared frightened. There was nothing healing about this atmosphere of intimidation. And Bowditch conceded Stewart's point that it hadn't been conducive to arriving at the truth. Even within Jehovah's Witness literature, there's an acknowledgement that far from healing, confrontations can cause more damage and trauma, sparking denial and more abuse. The organization's literature even acknowledges that forgiveness isn't necessarily appropriate. The point has to be made that an all-knowing God would know how damaging these confrontations could be for abused individuals. So, who determined that these confrontations should be judicial procedure? Was it a callous, incompetent God? Or callous, incompetent humans falsely claiming to speak for a God? Like all his colleagues, Ron DeRoy, an elder for 29 years, declined to view BCG's testimony. When asked why, he said he didn't want to listen to it so he could be objective. He said he wanted to be honest in any questions that he was asked. But it later emerged that he had watched Dino Ally's testimony. Stewart asked if he wasn't concerned that this would jeopardize his objectivity. DeRoy replied he wanted to be honest. So, he avoided BCG's testimony because he wanted to be honest, but watched Ally's testimony because he wanted to be honest. It didn't hang together. It didn't go unnoticed that all the elders had avoided BCG's testimony, echoing the real-life shunning of ex-members practiced by the organization. One individual who didn't follow this pattern was an ex-Jehovah's Witness called Monty Baker. formerly an elder of the congregation to which BCG's father eventually moved. Unlike De Roy and the other elders, Baker had followed the proceedings closely, including BCG's testimony. As a result, many old memories came back to him, prompting him to make several amendments to his initial statement. He said he was sure the significance of the occasion would motivate everyone giving evidence to be fully clear on every aspect. De Roy appeared to have virtually no recollection of his part in the elders' investigation into BCG's allegations. He claimed he couldn't recall a single detail of the acts of molestation BCG reported to him and the other elders, which led to a confusing moment when, some way into his testimony, he seemed keen to impress upon the commission that he was sickened by what BCG's father did to her. Stuart asked what sickened him. After some prevarication, he grinned and claimed he couldn't remember. De Roy's testimony followed a distinct pattern. When asked about his involvement in the BCG investigation, he claimed no memory. When confronted with an alleged event that put him in an especially bad light, on top of claiming no memory, he also tried to argue that it couldn't have happened. An example of this was when Stuart read from BCG's statement that De Roy had said he didn't want to talk to her sisters because they were too young to know what they were talking about. De Roy claimed not to recall this. Stuart asked if he was saying it didn't happen. De Roy evaded the question and instead commented that if the elders had known her sisters were abused too, that would have given them more witnesses to follow through on. Stuart then presented Dino Ally's own handwritten notes confirming that the elders did know about BCG's sisters and that her father had confessed. De Roy then claimed to remember very precisely that at the first judicial meeting, the elders only had BCG's word against her father. But this supposed precise memory did nothing to erase the hard evidence of Ally's notes, which supported BCG's testimony that her sister's abuse was reported, but ignored. Throughout De Roy's testimony, he repeatedly delivered flippant responses with the same bizarre grin. When Judge McClellan asked him if he thought it was right that after her father was disfellowshipped, it was BCG who was removed from the family home, while her abuser remained there, De Roy grinned and said if he'd cared about his daughter, he would have made it a lot easier for her. To expect care from a father who'd beaten and threatened BCG and molested all of his daughters was maybe the clearest mark of De Roy's total rejection of personal responsibility. De Roy's responses ranged from vague to garbled to obtuse. At one point, Stuart put it to him that he was speaking in riddles. Reflecting on his conduct to the commission, it was sobering to think this individual was responsible for the care of abused children. Further damning facts about the organization emerged when some Jehovah's Witness officials were brought in to explain the organization's policies and procedures. Rodney Spinks, a Jehovah's Witness for over 40 years, was a senior member of the service department in the organization's branch office and assisted elders in implementing guidelines for handling child abuse allegations. Vincent Toole, baptized in 1972, had overseen operations in the legal department of the branch office since 2010. Terence O'Brien, baptized in 1976, was the current coordinator of the Jehovah's Witness Australia Branch Committee. Spinks was first to give evidence, and it soon became clear that the organization's documentation for handling child abuse allegations was hopelessly fragmented. There was no clear, centralized set of guidelines that was accessible to all congregants. Spinks said the guidelines were outlined in various sources, including the organization's translation of the Bible, a confidential elder's handbook called Shepherd the Flock of God, confidential letters sent to the body of elders, and articles in the organization's magazines, like the Watchtower. In one farcical moment, Spinks said he'd found a document showing abused individuals didn't have to confront their abusers, but admitted no one had a copy of the document until they found an older member of the department who'd photocopied it, reduced it, and stuck it in his book. Stuart commented that it was like trying to put your finger on a ball of mercury. Just when you think you have it, it pops up somewhere else. If senior advisors couldn't navigate their own guidelines, what hope did an abused child have? The passive language of the guidelines also became apparent. Stuart noted that there was no instruction in the Confidential Elder's Handbook to actively inform congregants of their right to contact authorities. Only if the elders were asked were they to tell congregants it was their personal decision. This is not the advice of a supportive organization, but of one that wants no involvement. Any abused individual who fails to raise the subject themselves will never get the reassurance that it's their right to go to the police. The end result is that abusers are shielded from the police. Stuart highlighted the hypocrisy of this passive position, putting it to Spinks that if he saw someone breaking into a neighbor's house, or received reliable information of a murder, he'd immediately report it to the police. Spinks confirmed he would. Beyond hypocrisy, Judge McClellan explained to Spinks the potential criminality of not reporting. If elders determine that an allegation is true, it ceases to be knowledge of an allegation and becomes knowledge or belief of a criminal offence. In New South Wales, where Spinks was based, criminal sanctions could be imposed on people who knew or believed a criminal offence had been committed and didn't report. Stuart further noted that if contacting child protection authorities was an automatic first step, there'd be no need for elders to interview the child. Elders who, Stuart noted, had no training in interviewing traumatized children. Spinks agreed. McClellan also noted that civil authorities had the benefit of decades of scientific research in the assessment and treatment of abusers, none of which was available to the Jehovah's Witnesses. Research that underscored the high risk of reoffending. But, in a jarring moment of defiance, Spinks had already said the Bible would prevail over science, and had proudly cited Jehovah's Witnesses in South Korea, Russia, Azerbaijan, and Eritrea who'd gone to prison for their beliefs. He said the organization would continue to reprove and reinstate individuals who showed themselves sufficiently repentant. When it was put to him that there was a clear inducement for people to pretend to be repentant, if it meant they avoided punishment, Spinks conceded that was possible. Vincent Toole admitted to receiving 3 or 4 allegations of child sexual abuse every month. A trained solicitor himself, Toole conceded no formal training was required to be an elder, even though the position entailed far-reaching responsibility for the welfare of many people. Toole claimed that before someone was nominated as an elder, the organization would use a formal working with children clearance check to establish a clean record. But Stuart noted that such checking systems depend on accurate databases of sexual offenses. If the authorities aren't informed of offenses, then the efficacy of the checking is compromised. With the Jehovah's Witnesses' record of not reporting offences, it seemed the organisation wanted to benefit from this external database, but not contribute to it. Toole repeatedly claimed he'd have no hesitation reporting abuse to the police, but only if there was no other way to protect the child. In practice, this situation is highly unlikely because the organisation believes it provides effective protection by moving children out of their homes, like they did with BCG. In the process, cutting her off from family life. And indeed, when Toole was asked directly whether he'd ever gone to the police, he admitted he hadn't. Toole initially claimed the legal department had been instructed to direct elders to clearly tell victims they have an absolute right to report their abuse to authorities. But when asked to cite these instructions, he couldn't. He scaled down to a lesser claim that it was in the spirit of the organization's literature to report. And he admitted he'd received no formal instructions. Toole played the human rights champion, repeatedly claiming the organization's reluctance to contact authorities was about protecting people's right to decide what was in their own best interests. But genuine human rights champions inform people of their rights, because without that awareness, people can't exercise their rights. In contrast, Jehovah's Witness children have been kept unaware of their rights. Tall protested that they didn't live in a cocoon, but they do. The Jehovah's Witness organization is a separatist group whose literature repeatedly warns against bad associations with non-members. Chapter 5 of the organization's book, Keep Yourself in God's Love, is explicitly titled, How to Keep Separate from the World, and opens with John 15, verse 19. You are not part of this world. You don't have to be physically isolated to be effectively cocooned. You simply have to be kept in trusting ignorance, warned against associating with non-members, and threatened with punishment or even abandonment for disobedience. When asked what improvements the Jehovah's Witness organization could make in handling child sexual abuse, Terence O'Brien was quite forthcoming. He said clearer documentation was needed regarding policy. The right to report needed to be clearly explained, and procedures needed to be clearly explained to anyone alleging abuse. One thing O'Brien wasn't clear on was protecting the congregation. McClellan asked how the elders would safeguard the congregation if they fully believed the allegations of abuse against someone but couldn't meet the organization's requirements for proof, like the two-witness rule. O'Brien said the elders would put restrictions on that person's association with children. When McClellan noted that this depended on elders observing the transgression, O'Brien added that congregants could report it to them, but McClellan pointed out that congregants wouldn't know to report it because they weren't told about the restrictions. O'Brien agreed. The lack of basic thought given to safeguarding procedures was staggering. O'Brien ruled out any change regarding the two-witness rule, or giving women a role in the investigative process. He confirmed the bizarre scriptural reasons for forbidding women to exercise authority over men, citing 1 Timothy chapter 2. Reason 1. Adam was formed before Eve. This is a straightforward non sequitur. The birth order of the Bible's first two humans has no logical connection to the respective attributes of modern men and women. Reason 2. Adam wasn't deceived, but Eve was. In fact, according to the Bible, Adam and Eve both succumbed to exactly the same inducement, being told they wouldn't die if they ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So, this second reason is a lie, one for which female Jehovah's Witnesses pay. On the subject of lies, it emerged that O'Brien had knowingly given the commission false information about a potential witness. McClellan had previously inquired about the possibility of hearing from a member of the organization's governing body, one Jeffrey Jackson, who was currently in Australia. Under instruction from O'Brien, counsel for the Jehovah's Witness organization, Mr. Tockley, told the commission that Jackson would probably not be any assistance because his role was confined to translating material. But in fact, as a member of the governing body, Jackson was part of an elite ruling council of anointed servants, giving direction to the organization, approving publications, and shaping doctrine. And O'Brien knew it. McClellan took a dim view of this misrepresentation, and Jackson was summoned. The subterfuge that surrounded Jeffrey Jackson's appearance at the commission would continue into his testimony, which was full of diversions, evasions, ambiguities, and falsehoods. He would repeatedly sidestep the point of a question, often reinventing the question. For example, when Judge McClellan asked him if there was any biblical impediment to a woman being appointed to investigate an allegation, Jackson replied that there was no impediment to a woman being involved with the investigation. He persisted with this particular evasion ad nauseam, and only gave a straight answer when eventually Stewart remarked that a person making tea during the investigation is involved. The question was about who makes the decision. Following O'Brien's lead, Jackson made several misrepresentations about his role in the organization. He presented an egalitarian fantasy in which governing body members viewed themselves merely as fellow workers with other Jehovah's Witnesses, and suggested that if the governing body gave some direction not in harmony with divine word, it would be picked up on by Jehovah's Witnesses worldwide. In reality, The governing body is an authority that determines all the organization's policies and procedures, and it expects obedience. Individuals can be disfellowshipped for disagreeing with them on the charge of causing divisions. For example, some Jehovah's Witnesses have called for the reform of the doctrine forbidding blood transfusions. As reformists have noted, the scripture presented in justification of this doctrine explicitly mentions eating blood. There is no biblical concept of transfusions. But for expressing this disagreement, reformists have been disfellowshipped. When Stewart asked him if they saw themselves as Jehovah's spokespeople on earth, Jackson said that would seem quite presumptuous. But in a 2001 article in the organization's Watchtower magazine, the governing body explicitly argued that it wasn't presumptuous of Jehovah's Witnesses to point out that they alone had the backing of the biblical God. Jackson also misrepresented the organization's stance on corporal punishment. McClellan asked straightforwardly if his church accepted the corporal punishment of children. Jackson evaded the question, saying his church expected that parents have the responsibility to discipline and raise their children. McClellan said that didn't answer his question, and repeated it. After more evasions, Jackson finally said the organization didn't accept or encourage it. But the Watchtower magazine explicitly promotes both verbal and physical punishment. An article called Disciplining Children for Life claims a spanking can be a lifesaver to a child, and says that beating children with a rod won't kill them. It suggests a rebuke can work for meeker children, whereas a whipping should discipline more stubborn children. A 2006 article called Reliable Advice for Raising Children also promotes a combination of the rod and reproof, charitably noting not all children need physical punishment. Returning to the issue of sexual abuse, McClellan asked about the possibility of giving women a decision-making role. After some evasion, Jackson confirmed the organization's doctrine that only men could be judges and claimed this was based on scripture. But Jackson forgot the prophetess Deborah, whose story is told in chapter 4 of the Bible's Book of Judges. The book depicts 6 major and 6 minor judges. Deborah was a major judge who made legal decisions. It would seem there is biblical precedent for giving women decision-making roles. When Stewart put it to him that many females would feel more comfortable speaking to a woman about their abuse, Jackson rejected the idea. He said unlike what he called your churches, where people didn't talk to each other, Jehovah's Witness congregations became familiar and friendly. Leaving aside his ignorant comment on the social relationships of other churches, his argument appeared to be that any abused female members should feel comfortable speaking to the men. Like the elders testifying before him, he seemed unable to grasp the reality that many don't. Stewart questioned Jackson about disassociation when individuals state they no longer want to be known as a Jehovah's Witness. It's a course of action many abused individuals feel driven to take when their molesters go unpunished and remain in their congregations. The problem is, if you disassociate, you get shunned. So, having been abused, you then lose your entire social network. Jackson rejected the idea that people who no longer wanted to be known as a Jehovah's Witness had to disassociate. He said they could choose to simply become inactive, also known as fading. But Stewart noted that inactive members were still subject to the rules and discipline of the organization. In a moment of staggering disingenuousness, Jackson claimed he'd have to check because it wasn't his field. Stewart persisted, putting it to Jackson that there was no middle road. You were either a member or you weren't. If you fade, you're still subject to the organization's discipline and rules. Having just claimed it wasn't his field, Jackson now confirmed this was true. Jackson conveniently forgot another fact about inactive witnesses. Even though they're still officially considered Jehovah's Witnesses, in practice, they're often actively avoided and excluded by other witnesses on the grounds that their lack of activity makes them a bad association. Sometimes, there's little practical difference between this exclusion and formal shunning. Like the elders who testified before him, Jackson, with his constant evasions and equivocations, exposed himself as a man of no principle, unwilling to state the true doctrines of the organization. And this highlighted a particularly damning hypocrisy. When molesters escaped justice on the grounds that neither a second witness or a confession was produced, the organization offers abused individuals the supposed consolation that the matter will be left in Jehovah's hands, the message being that they need to brave the hardships of this earthly life because divine justice will ultimately prevail. But if Jackson had such conviction in ultimate divine justice himself, he'd proclaim his beliefs proudly, braving any earthly hardships that resulted from his faith. Instead, in order to escape earthly criticism, he takes refuge in misrepresenting his religion, while abused individuals are expected to endure their earthly suffering. He is a hypocrite and a coward. In 2017, 18 months after the Commission's Case 29 explored the Jehovah's Witness Organization's response to the abuse of BCB and BCG, the Commission initiated Case 54, a follow-up investigation in which Rodney Spinks and Terence O'Brien were called back to report what progress, if any, had been made by the organization. The Commission requested that a governing body member be available in person or by video to give evidence in this important follow-up hearing. The request was denied. Despite the extensive time it was given, the organization had managed to produce just 3 meager documents, including a letter to all elders and a guide for the service desk. Like other procedural documents produced by the organization, the service desk guide was inexplicably classified as strictly confidential, not even for the eyes of the service desk secretaries. The cases of BCB and BCG had highlighted the damage caused by the organization's lack of procedural transparency. But Spinks and O'Brien were unable to explain why congregation members were still being kept from information about processes that governed their lives. A third document had been drafted just 3 days before the commission hearing. It hadn't been published or distributed, and Stewart spotted some obvious flaws and significant ambiguities in the text. Spinks conceded the wording still needed work, but repeatedly claimed more rigorous practices were now in place. When invited to support that claim with documentation, he admitted he couldn't. So, instead of a public, centralized policy document, the picture remained fragmented. Judge McClellan noted, unless their intentions were clearly reflected in their policy documents, there was a good chance they'd just fall backwards. Predictably, the organization rejected the key findings of the commission. It continued to demand 2 witnesses. It also rejected the possibility of women having a decision-making role. And it stood by its practice of shunning abused individuals who felt driven to leave the control of their congregations in order to escape their abusers. O'Brien continued to assert that it was their own choice to be shunned. There was a strong element of stagey performance as he defiantly declared that in regard to the shunning policy, Jehovah was their judge, Jehovah was their lawgiver, Jehovah was their king. The BCB and BCG hearings revealed an organization with its fingers firmly in its ears. To expect change to come from within this secretive, deceptive, controlling organization is, I believe, futile. Energies are much better spent, as BCG suggested, making it financially and criminally accountable for failing the children in its congregations, and, like the work of the Australian Royal Commission, bringing its damaging practices to public attention, exposing abuse.